Thanks for having me. And yeah, welcome to my talk about writing a kernel driver with Rust. So, yeah. Let me turn that off. So who am I? I'm Matthias. I'm 19 years old, and I'm a software developer. I really have a passion for developing and programming software. And I also like to explore new technologies on my own time. And that's also how I learned about Rust. And I also have an interest in software security. For example, obfuscation techniques, anti-debugging techniques, and antivirus, DRM, anti-cheats, and all that stuff is really interesting. So, yeah, let's look at the agenda. We'll look into what exactly a kernel driver is, who uses a kernel driver, and how we can build our own kernel driver with Rust. And then also a short conclusion and a quick Q&A. All right, let's get started. To be able to understand what a kernel driver is, we need to understand the difference between user mode and kernel mode. So in user mode, all your applications like Chrome, Word, or Discord run. And you can interact with the kernel where the kernel drivers run. And the kernel drivers interact with the CPU, memory, or devices like the network card. And this one important concept, the kernel has access to everything. So if you don't know what you're doing, you can easily crash and end up with this screen. So everybody has seen it. This is the blue screen. This happens, for example, if you corrupt critical data, or in this case, when a critical process dies. So the operating system can no longer be run safely. So we need to do a restart and yeah. All right. And you can usually recognize kernel drivers with the .sys extension. Okay, who uses kernel drivers? So of course, first of all, antivirus software, because they can log much more data than in the user mode. And for example, can also register callbacks that notify them when a new process is created or when a DLL is injected somewhere. And they can prevent that and block that from happening. And they also have far more options to detect suspicious behavior. Then also anti-cheats or cheats. So anti-cheats in general want to protect a game. Or more specifically, they want to protect the game's memory so it can't get edited. And if the anti-cheat runs in the user mode, they are very limited because they can easily be circumvented if you develop your own kernel driver, because the kernel driver has access to everything. And yeah, then there's also the NSA or hackers or malware developers in general. So there's rootkits or bootkits, and they are very hard to detect because they have access to everything. So they can also easily achieve persistence by, for example, rewriting the master boot record or doing some other tricky stuff. And often in the kernel, there's often many techniques that are not known. So there's lots of potential for abuse. Luckily, Microsoft knows this and decided to implement some protection for that. For example, Patch Guard will look for suspicious behavior. For example, Windows has internally a linked list with all the processes. And if for whatever reason a process is not in the linked list, then the system will just crash with a blue screen because it obviously shouldn't ever happen. And there's also newer, more secure techniques like virtualization-based security, which uses a hypervisor and is even harder to circumvent. And also companies like NVIDIA, AMD, or any other company that needs to have access to the hardware. And yeah, for example, also network drivers also use kernel drivers. Okay, let's get into the how. How can we implement our own kernel driver? So the first thing we want to do is create a new project. We can use Cargo for that, like Rainer showed us in a previous talk, and we create a new binary crate called driver. All right, so a normal Rust application would look somewhat like this, but obviously this doesn't work yet and can't be run in the kernel. So we need to adjust it. So the first thing we should do is remove the standard library, because the standard library provides lots of abstractions, for example, printing to the console. But if we try to build the project now, we get an error: panic handler, function required, but not found. Okay, let's implement it ourselves. So now we added a new function called panic, and we get a panic invoice parameter. And this is pretty simple. Whenever our program panics, crashes, normally the standard library implements a panic handler on its own. So if we crash in the user mode, there will be a nice error message and stack trace printed into the console. But in the kernel, there's no console, so we can't do that and we have to implement it ourselves. So here we can notice the exclamation mark. This just means that this function does not return. And we can just place an infinite loop there, and this will not yet compile, but Rust will be satisfied. All right, the next thing we need to do is create our own entry point, because normally we have the C runtime, which gets called before our actual main entry point. But in the kernel, a driver entry or new function is the first thing that gets called. So we name it driver entry because that's usually the name in the kernel. So we stick with that. Then we adjust the return value to an unsigned 32-bit integer. And we return 0, which stands for status success. Then we also use the correct application binary interface with the extant system. This just makes sure that LLVM and Rust, so that the correct registers are used for the return value and parameters. And then the nomangle just makes sure that Rust does not modify the function name in the binary. All right, so we also need to adjust the crate type in our cargo.toml, because kernel drivers are actually kind of similar to dynamic linked libraries, DLLs. And the only difference there is they use different imports. So we can just rename our main.rs to lib.rs and adjust the crate type to c.dylib. One important thing here is don't use dylib. Dylib is used for Rust libraries, and this includes lots of metadata. So if you want a large driver, then you can use dylib, but in general, you don't want to use it. So we'll just use c.dylib, which removes the metadata. I actually stumbled upon this because I was wondering why my Hello World kernel driver has 180 kilobytes. And until I found that out, it was actually 5 kilobytes large. All right, so if we want to compile the program, it still doesn't yet work. We need to adjust the linker settings. So in Rust, we can specify a cargo.config. And we specify the target, in my case, Windows MSVC. And then we have prelink and postlink args. The most important ones here are entry in the postlinked args, the second one, where we specify our function we created. This is the first thing that gets called. And in the prelinked args, we specify slash driver to make sure that we actually build a Windows kernel driver. All right, so now we should be able to compile the project, but we can't yet use any kernel APIs. For that, we need to tell the linker where all the libraries are. So this, you don't have to look at all the code. This basically does the following. So we look up the path to the Windows kernel driver kit. This is done via the registry, but that's not important right now. Then we select the correct platform, for example, 64-bit or 32-bit. And then we just specified with the Cargo Rust C link search, native and printed to the console. And if we do that in the build script, Rust will automatically search in the following directories. So we should now be able to call kernel APIs. So in this case, we have to define the function ourselves. So I'm using mm is address valid. This basically checks if the parsed virtual address, if a page fault will occur. So a page fault is basically when the address cannot be accessed. So if the address is valid, this should return true because a page fault will not occur. And I also specified the type pvoid because in Windows, that's usually used for addresses and it makes it easier to copy paste the definitions from MSDN. All right, so now we can use the function. We have obviously have to wrap it into an unsafe because Rust cannot verify that this function is actually there, and we can just pass zero. And then we can print it. I created a log macro, which we'll see in the next slide, and then we print it. All right, so the log macro looks like this. We are using another kernel function called debug print. This is similar to printf, but prints to the kernel output. And there's two versions of it. The first one is we just print a string. And the second one is we print a string with arguments. Then we also use the concat macro to add a prefix and the postfix, the null terminator, which is in this case really important because as you probably know, C and C++ have a null terminator at the end of every string. So that they know where the string ends. And yeah, and if you look at this example, you might already see a security vulnerability because in this case, we can pass any arguments. So if you go back to the previous slide, for example, we could pass, we could specify %i, but don't pass is valid. So we would print the string and debug print would look in the stack and check and just take the next variable that's there and print it onto the console. And this can be quite serious vulnerability and can be abused. Obviously in our case not, but if you have user input, then it can be abused. Okay, let's look at a comparison between Rust and C or C++. So you might have a function like this in C. The function is named do something. We get a process ID. And then we look up the process by a process ID. And the output parameter is the PE process structure, a pointer to the E process structure. And then we check if it's successful. If it's not, we return false. And then you can already see an important thing. We have two conditions there. And in both conditions, we return. So we have to dereference the object before we return because internally a reference counter is added. So we need to subtract one from that via the dereference object function. And at the end, we need to do that too. But you can imagine, if you don't watch out, you can easily forget it and potentially leak memory in some other cases. All right, how could we do that in Rust? So first of all, I would create a process structure. And internally, we just store the pointer to the eProcess structure. And then we can create a new function called byID and pass the process ID. Then, as before, we look up the process, check if it's successful. And here comes an important feature of Rust. We can return some if we actually got something and none if it failed. So no more null pointers in Rust, which is awesome. So here comes the most important thing of Rust. In Rust, there's this trait called drop. This gets always called whenever the object goes out of scope. So in our case, we check if the process is null, is not null, and if it's not null, we can dereference the object. So if we take the previous function and rewrite it in Rust, it will look like this. So it already looks a lot simpler. So first we create a new process structure. This is our process, not the PE process structure. And then at the end, we have the question mark operator. This basically says, if byID returns none, return from this function and return also none. But if it returns some with the process object, then just unwrap that and store it in the process variable. And then we can just do the conditions. And we basically don't have to care about deallocation or other stuff. And then we can return again. And when the function returns, drop gets called and calls the dereference object function, which is awesome because Rust does this automatically. We don't have to do it ourselves. So no more errors, no more human errors. All right, here comes a kind of tricky topic, Unicode strings, because in the kernel, almost every function that has a string as parameter uses Unicode strings. And Unicode strings are special because they're not one byte, but actually two bytes. And Windows also has a special structure called Unicode string, all in uppercase. And in order to pass our own Unicode string to a Windows kernel function, we need to first convert it. And in the kernel, you don't have access to the standard library. So you can't just make an iterator over a normal string, convert it into U16, and then collect it into a vec, because a vector is not available in kerning because you don't have access to the standard library. So I found this cool crate that does this for us. So it's called offstring, and there's the white macro. And this macro basically returns a slice of unsigned 16-bit integers. And 16-bit integers are 2 bytes wide. And then we can just create our own Unicode structure, Unicode string structure. And there's also a Windows kernel API for that. But in my opinion, we can just do it ourselves because we can't make any mistakes if we do it ourselves. And yeah, so we just get the length, then get the character count. And Windows is kind of weird. So we have the length and the maximum length. Length is actually the length without the null character. And maximum length is the length with the null character. And then we just store a pointer to the string in the buffer. All right, so what if we wanted to use STD features like vector, hash map, or string, or other stuff? So we can actually create our own allocator So we can use vector in the kernel.
Matthias, do you have a technical problem?
Yeah, my headphones turned off.
Yeah, okay, it's fine. Sorry.
Okay.
Go on.
So, yeah, so we can actually implement our own allocator. And we do that by using the global alloc trait. So we have our own struct called kernel alloc, and then we implement the global alloc trait. And we have to implement two functions, alloc and dealloc. And they're pretty straightforward. We just allocate the pool in the alloc and free it in the dealloc. And also a alloc error handler. This is just important if we ran out of memory, but yeah. Okay. Let's look at Rust bindchain. If you don't know Rust bindchain, this is a tool that allows to automatically generate Rust bindings to C or C++. But in some cases, it can get quite weird. So for example, in this example, we have a physical address. We initialize it with stdmem0, oh, that should be core mem0. And then we get access to the quad part. You might now think, this is weird. Why do we have to get quadpart underscore mute? Why do we have to call the function? And why can we only then modify the quadpart variable? Well, if you look at the C bindings behind it, you'll see this. A physical address is a large integer. In the large integer, oh, it's a union. So this is a disadvantage of Rust, because Rust actually has a union, but you shouldn't use it. And a union, if you don't know it, it basically says the quad part is an int 64. So it's 8 bytes on 64-bit machines. And then we also have the struct with the low part and high part, which are ulong and long, which are both 4 bytes. So together, they are also 8 bytes. And union says we can either access the struct or the quad part. So they both point to the same memory and we can modify it if we want. So we don't have to do some bit shifting and stuff, which is pretty cool, but can also be really dangerous. So yeah, that's the downside of Rust bindchain. Okay, let's come to another downside. So unsafe. You obviously shouldn't use unsafe, but here's a project, kernel driver written in Rust, and it's actually generated with Tokay, which is also a tool written in Rust, which counts statistics of projects. For example, lines of code written. And we can see in total, I've written about 3,700 lines of Rust code. And in this code, I've used 205 unsafe blocks, because in the kernel, you can't really do anything without the standard library. You have to access Windows kernel functions. So if you I already implemented lots of abstractions, so I don't have to call unsafe over and over again. But all the functions also return raw pointers, which are obviously unsafe. So yeah. And yeah, let's come to raw pointers. So for example, in a normal Rust application, you could have something like this. You store a raw pointer in the variable something. And obviously you have to check whether the pointer is null, because when you use it later, you can crash. So we check it with an if something is null, and then maybe return or do something else. And then later use it with the function foo. So this is really a lot of code just for a point of validation. So we can use traits and optimize it. So first of all, create a new trait called point of validity. And we create a function in there called valid, and it captures self and return an option of self. And we also need to specify that self is sized because we capture the variable and return it again. Now, so we can implement it for both mutable pointers, but also constant pointers. So this will look like this. So we have impl t, so it's generic. For every mutable pointer, we implement this trait. So, and in this function, we just check if self is null, is not null, we return a sum of self. And if it's null, we return none. And now we can actually do something like this. We can use the question mark operator again. And for example, in most cases, you want to return out of the function. And this makes the code really clean and simple. And then we can use it in foo again. All right. Now, should I use Rust when writing a kernel driver? This is a hard question. Let's look at the pros and cons. So obviously, the cons. There's no official bindings yet, because I doubt anyone's using kernel drivers in production or somewhere. So there's some bindings for it, but they're very incomplete, and you have to implement all the functions yourself, declare the functions yourself, like we did with the mm is address valid, which can also be tedious because you have to go on the internet and look up the function definition, convert it to Rust. And if you're using undocumented stuff, this can be even harder. And yeah, bindchain isn't perfect. I have another example in the project I mentioned, where bindchain, for whatever reason, generated some kind of anon gen one variable. I don't know why it exists, but it's, yeah, that's it. And Unicode strings. If you don't have a util function, a util module or something that automatically converts your Rust string slices into Unicode strings, it's really tedious. And also lots of raw pointers, which can lead to vulnerabilities, crashes and stuff, and you need to obviously need to use unsafe for them. But there's also pros. So Rust does a lot of stuff at compile time. So obviously there's fewer crashes. And when you crash, when you have a blue screen, the entire operating system shuts down. And until it restarts, it can take some time. So this is obviously also a speed up in the development. And we can create a custom allocator, and then we can use stuff from the standard library. And as far as I know, C++ has no way to do that. So you can't just use any C++ type from the standard library in the kernel, which is obviously a downside because you don't want to implement it yourself because it can error prone. And then many people can decide they create their own implementation. Then you have, then you can use many of these implementations and you have to look at them and select the best one. So yeah, custom allocator is a pretty big point, and I'm really glad that Rust has this feature. Then also TRUP. You now don't have to care about deallocation anymore, which makes life a lot simpler. And option and result. So no more null pointers, and yeah, it's pretty cool. And also crates.io and docs.rs. So right now there aren't really many crates you can use in the kernel because the ecosystem is just not there. Obviously, you can use crates that have NoSDD support, for example, SERDE. The deserialization and serialization library has NoSDD support, which is pretty cool. So you could interact with the user mode and the kernel mode driver via JSON, for example, and also docs.rs, which allows you to host your documentation for these crates. And in general, the entire Rust ecosystem, the Rust toolchain, because Cargo, you can simply build it with Cargo, which is also pretty nice. You don't need any other tools. It just works. And yeah, are there any questions?
Matthias, first, let me say thank you for the presentation. It's really awesome. I know you are rather fresh from school and you did a great job. It was really interesting. And yeah, congratulations for this really interesting topic. Yes, we have a bunch of questions. In your slides, we saw the Win API, and we have a question. Does the Win API abstract kernel space APIs in Windows, or can you elaborate a little bit what this use Win API does and what it is?
I hope this one it is.
Yes, it is an example. Yep.
Okay. Okay. So in general, Windows. So this is just the definition of the Unicode string structure. And in Windows, you can use it both in the kernel, but also in the user mode. So there's this Win API create, and in the shared module, that's all the stuff you can use in the kernel and in the user mode. But you cannot use, for example, what's a user mode function? For example, create process, because it simply does not exist in the kernel. And if you try to call it in the kernel driver, you'll get a linker error because it cannot find the library for that. Mm-hmm. I hope that's answered the question.
I guess so. We will get a follow-up question if it didn't. One thing, a question from my side, I would be curious. During your research for this whole project of writing a kernel driver in Rust, I guess you looked through the internet. Did you find any clues about more or less official statements, for instance, from Microsoft that they are planning or going to release better Rust support for, let's say, system level programming in Windows or something like this? Did you find anything in that direction?
So I have not seen anything where they mentioned specifically that they want to use it for kernel drivers in general or release crates with bindings for it. But I've seen some statements where they talked about that they want to use Rust more and or want to begin using Rust side to side next to C++.
Yeah, maybe then we will get better libraries and better support on the Rust side. We'll see. The next question is a question somebody, Christian, was curious. It's not just Rust related, but generally, while you were developing your kernel driver, how did you test this kernel driver? I mean, there are a lot of people, including me in this talk, who have never written a kernel driver. Is it just like pressing debugger start and you can debug your stuff and set breakpoints? Or how does that feel? How does that look like?
So it's actually not that simple. So I've actually skipped a part of that in my blog. You can read about it if you want. I also added a section where I created a build script, which builds the kernel driver. But you can't just click on run and the kernel driver runs. You have to either manually use a tool and start it, or I guess you could also write a script for that, but you also have to start your IDE always as administrator because, yeah, you need administrator rights to start the kernel driver. Mm-hmm. And you also, in Windows, you have to enable a specific mode. It's called test mode, where some stuff is disabled because otherwise you can't load your own kernel driver because you need to buy a certificate and sign it and all that stuff. And then, so I was using a virtual machine. Then you can just copy the driver file there, run it, and there's another tool called Debug View, which you have opened, opened in the VM, and there you can see all the kernel outputs. There's also debuggers, but they're not really built into the IDE. So yeah, it's a lot more work than just a regular user mode application.
Okay, thank you very much. I just saw that the speaker from last time sent a bunch of informations about how to debug it with Qemu. I'm not sure, I'm not familiar with this technology. I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing it correct, but everybody who is interested might take a look at our Discord server, and there are some tips going on here. Also, Harald is mentioning that in Linux, there are efforts to support Rust, but he guesses this will also take a while, and he mentions an article that you can follow along if you want to read more. You mentioned a sample that you have written. Can you please, after your talk, if that's possible, maybe you share a link to a blog or post or maybe a GitHub repository so that people who are interested can take a look at the entire working sample and maybe get some additional learnings from the work that you did. Mm-hmm. Christian, a testing related question. That's an interesting one, and I'm really looking forward to your answer. Is there any way of doing things like automated testing or unit testing code like that? How do you approach that?
So I was actually wondering in the early development of the kernel driver, I was wondering if that's possible, and I couldn't find a simple way of doing that without implementing everything myself.
Okay.
So yeah, that's an obvious downside.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. We have another question coming in. There was a slide about driver entry.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and I think Mikkel is the name. He is a little bit confused. What was the system for the pop extern?
So, there's different APIs, application binary interfaces. And this basically tells the compiler, in our case, Rust uses LLVM, that certain registers should be used for something. So in Windows, parameters are always in RCX, RDX, R8, R9, and then on the stack, and so on. And the return value is always in the RAX register. And if you change the extern and then the application binary interface, you can tell basically LLVM that you want a different system. For example, does STD call or this call, I'm not sure if this call is supported, but their EZX always stores a pointer to the current object. And so, yeah, it's basically a flag for LLVM, as far as I know.
I see. Okay, I hope that clarifies the question. If not, let a follow-up question come along, please. A question from Christian. He's obviously not that into kernel development like I am. So he asked, did you see a lot of blue screens during debugging and testing, or what were your experiences here?
Yeah. Especially in the beginning, because I made a mistake. Because, for example, there's a function called mmgetSystemRoutineAddress. This returns a pointer to a certain function. And obviously, pointers are unsafe. And when you incorrectly dereference it or dereference it one too often or one too less, you get a page fault and then a blue screen. So yeah, definitely in the beginning, I had a lot of blue screens.
I really can imagine that. I already see people discussing calling conventions and things like that. Matthias, if you have time and if you want, it would be great after this talk that you join us on the Discord server. Maybe people have additional questions. And if you can jump in and add your views to the discussion and maybe provide some answers, that is really great. Let me close today's meetup by saying again, thank you very much for this very interesting talk. Just like with the first talk, we will take this video and cut it in the next few days and put it on the official Rust channel. So with that, I